Okay, my name is Richard Gebhard. I've got a website out there called resilientmodeling.com. Ah, Bill, you showed up. Good job. And I've been working on this for about 4 years. I presented it at Solid Edge University 2013. At that time, it was a good idea. And I had a pretty good idea of the structure and everything. And I was hoping it would work. Now it's 2015. One thing I know for sure, it works. And since then, I've come up with a website. The website is resilientmodeling.com, and it's free, totally free. There aren't any teases or anything like that. It's free. And the purpose of the website is so that anyone that makes solid models can learn how to make better models, more robust models. And most importantly, it's CAD neutral. What I'm going to say here in the next 50 minutes applies to every modeling system, solid modeling system that has a feature tree. Because ProE has parent-child problems as well as SolidWorks, as well as Solid Edge. And by the way, if you have parent-child relationship problems or unstable models, it's 100% your fault. Because the author determines the feature sequence. Now that's something that's hard to teach. Don't know how well I've pulled it off, but I'd really appreciate feedback. So this is the required bio. There's one key thing there to take out of that. You're right, I'm older than dirt. Here, this is the abstract. And basically whatever is there is going to be repeated in the first video, so I'm just going to move through that. If you go to resilientmodeling.com, this is what you're going to see. It's not very impressive. And in fact, a lot of people have told me this is the most boring website they ever saw. This website is to educate, not to sell advertising. Also, it's designed to work wherever you are. The native resolution is 1920, I don't know. Anyway, it's the same as an iPhone. Okay? Most websites are designed for a PC, and then they have a mobile mode that kind of compresses things down and stretches it out about 3 feet. This one reads just perfect on a cell phone. So you're waiting for a plane, doctor's office, it'll work. So once you get there, all you do, you've got 8 buttons there. Pick your CAD system and get started. And this is the page you're going to see. This I call my table of contents page. This simplifies the navigation. You go from here to a video, and then you go back to this page. The interesting thing is I've got 8 buttons. They all go to the same page. And the reason for that is no one believes this is CAD neutral. Okay? So I got tired of fighting that and trying to convince people, so I just put the buttons up there, and everyone thinks they're in their unique thing for their CAD program, but it's all the same. The way this is organized, in this column here, this is the core of resilient modeling. And if you go through these 3 chapters, and you can see here, 3 minutes, 2 minutes, 5 minutes. 10 minutes, you'll know resilient modeling. You'll know what it's about. These, I call it my boring minutiae. Okay? And this is what I used to present in excruciating detail. And my friend said, look, it's like you're reading in a dictionary to someone. It's very useful, but it has no plot. And the idea is this: if you've got questions about the skeleton group, go there. It'll tell you everything you need to know. But don't go there to read and learn all the way down here. You'll fall asleep. So let's start. Loud enough back there? You hear it in the back row?
We have made models that can only be used once and probably can't even be edited. The resilient modeling strategy is a simple yet comprehensive technique for ordering the feature tree with the intent to control parent-child relationships. Everything a CAD user needs to understand and implement the resilient modeling strategy is included in this video series, and it is free to everyone. The goal of resilient modeling is to establish a standard process by which 3D CAD models can be understood, edited, and reused by anyone. The resilient modeling strategy allows anyone with overview knowledge of the CAD system to easily understand the design intent of a CAD model, to quickly find the specific features required to make an edit, and to be able to complete that edit without the model failing. What is the value of a model that can only be edited by its original author, if then? Have you ever had to remake a model because the original author left the company and the models that you inherited from them were indecipherable and unstable? Have you ever had to sift through the model tree of one of your own models to try and remember how it was created?
Embarrassing, isn't it?
Parent-child relationships are the heart of parametric design, but when misunderstood or misused, they are the source of many headaches and cost companies a lot of money. How many times has it been faster for us to make a new model from scratch instead of trying to fix a tree full of failed features? This type of model appears robust until someone has to make a change. Then the true value of the model is revealed. In the interest of speed, many designers keep working on a model until it looks right and dimensions correctly in a drawing. Every model is robust until someone tries to make an edit. Now imagine that the designer gets an ECO to increase the corner round. The original radius was 4 millimeters and will be changed to 4.1 millimeters. Even though it has been several months since this part was created, the designer finds that it is a simple and easy revision. The round in question is at the top of the feature tree and is quickly found and changed. The new CAD model is sent off to the shop floor and 500 units are made. Unfortunately, the new parts do not fit into the assembly due to an unintended parent-child relationship and an unobservable change in the distance between the dowel pin holes. The result is 500 scrap parts and a late delivery to what used to be their best customer. Every manufacturer has a similar story.
This completes Chapter 1, RMS Overview.
So now we're kind of in the rest of the story phase. That last model, they changed around and the mounting holes changed. Why did that happen? Well, here's the base feature. Notice it's got square corners there. They aren't square, but sharp edges. And there's a base feature there. You see all these dots there? They're actually blue on my screen. They're kind of messy purple here, but those are all the children of that one protrusion. The next feature, he rounded the corners. Okay? Second feature, he put a round in. There's nothing wrong with that. You can put a round anywhere, except for one thing. Don't let it become apparent. They're lousy parents. Okay? And as long as there aren't any parents to that round, it's perfectly safe. But if you dimension to its seam or something like that, that's when the fun begins. And sure enough, protrusion 7 here, right here, that was a derived edge from the round, and it was used to create this extrusion. And of course, this hole was centered on that. Hence, when you change the round radius, you're in trouble. The next chapter is obvious models. This is a prerequisite to doing any resilient modeling. And it's incredibly simple.
Hello, my name is Michael Hadley, and I'm delighted to welcome you to this brief introduction to resilient modeling strategy. An obvious model is one that can be read and understood by simply looking at the feature tree. Intuition is defined as the ability to interpret something without the need for conscious reasoning. Unfortunately, how we interpret something is completely dependent on our own personal history and experience. An intuitive model is nothing more than a reflection of the author's bias towards what he or she thinks should be obvious. But my assumptions regarding what should be obvious are not going to be the same as yours. So anything that is left open to interpretation will be, and not necessarily in the way that was intended. What is truly ironic is that power users are often the worst culprits of creating intuitive, solid models. The more experienced the modeler, the more likely they are to have developed an entire repertoire of shortcuts and workarounds. There is one single step required to replace intuition with conscious reasoning in a model. Rename features as they are made. Part of the purpose of a solid model is to communicate design intent. Labels like protrusion, sweep, and cut only describe the type of feature that has been created. By changing a feature's name to include function and quantity, suddenly the feature tree becomes a valuable resource for understanding without the need for interpretation. Unlike an intuitive model, an obvious model can be understood without having to step through the features. Take a look at the original tree for the connecting rod. If you wanted to modify the diameter of the hole at the end of the wrist pin hub, which feature would you go to? If you had just completed this model, you might remember where that feature is sitting in the tree. But 6 months from now, when tasked with an ECO, there is no way to know without stepping through the model or running a playback. Using the resilient modeling strategy, we already know that any hole is going to be in the hole loop. And when we look there, not only can we immediately see which hole we want to modify, we can see its current size. The resilient modeling strategy process takes the guesswork out of creating and editing solid models.
Could you turn the lights down just a little so it's easier to read? So that's it. You got to rename the features. If you don't rename the features, there's no way to figure out the model. I mean, protrusion one, surround one, cut one. That doesn't tell you anything. No, the other way. There you go. Ooh, looks like a new projector. Thank you. So anyway, here's an example. This is the way I got the model. This is it after renaming the features. If you don't rename them, you can't do anything. Okay, so now we're going to look at the third chapter. This is where we describe how we sequence the tree.
In the previous chapter, we learned how to create models that are obvious. In this chapter, we will learn how to create resilient models.
The order of the features in your feature tree completely controls the editability of your model. Most feature trees are the result of speed and convenience rather than careful forethought. We tend to make features and datums when and where we need them in order to make the model meet our part specification. Whenever we edit a feature, every feature below it in the tree regenerates. If the edited feature was apparent, every related feature will change as well, and then those features' children will be affected, and so forth. Making edits can be like pushing over the first in a row of dominoes.
There are four steps to creating a resilient model. Rename features, sequence features by functional groups, manage the hierarchy within the groups, pick the best parent. Think of the feature tree as the table of contents, or the index for your model. Which table of contents would you prefer? In resilient modeling, the feature tree is grouped using a standard format. The first group is the skeleton group. This group only contains reference features, such as surface bodies, layouts, or custom datums. Since they are at the top of the tree, any subsequent feature can use them. The second group is the core group. This group is like a super base feature, made up of fully constrained prismatic elements with hard edges. The third group is the surface group. It contains those reference features that depend on the core group. The detail group adds functionality to the core, such as slots, protrusions, cuts, and other details that complete the model. These features can link to any of the three previous groups, but they cannot link to other members of the detail group. The holes group has the same functionality as the detail group, except it is limited to cylindrical features that remove material. The modify group is where we perform patterns, mirrors, and drafts. The seventh group is the quarantine group, the final cosmetic features that remove or consume material, leaving derived edges. By placing them at the end of the tree, we have significantly reduced their ability to cause problems. Feature sequence within a group sets the parent feature priority.
I'll explain this later.
Resilient modeling manages the feature sequence so that only robust parent candidates are visible. For parent-child relationships, use rule 4.3. If you can see it, link to it. But pick the best parent, not the first. Default datums are the best choice, followed by user datums, then skeleton features, and lastly, core group features. If any of the elements chosen are children, pick their parent instead. Parent-child links within a group are allowed, except in the detail and holes group. Never link within the detail or holes group features. Links within the quarantine group are sensitive to feature sequence. One method to prevent accidentally linking to detail features is to suppress each detail feature after creation. If you want to try resilient modeling, request the instructions by sending an email to homework@resilientmodeling.com.
So now, this is it. Four steps. You got to rename the features. There's no point in sequencing this thing if you can't figure out, if you can't look at the tree and tell what the feature, what's the purpose of the feature. So then you sequence the features by functional groups. This is kind of a coarse grouping. The next step is within the group, you manage the hierarchy within the group, and that sets priorities. Like in your core group, you've got your base feature, and then you follow that with some other protrusions or something like that. So you can, within a group, you control the sequence of features. And then lastly, pick the best parent. When you're dimensioning to something, and our rule is, if you can see it in the background, dimension to it or link to it. Because this structure that we're putting in here is in there for a very specific purpose, because wherever you are in the feature tree, you're looking up. And all of those are good candidates, but there might be more than one. And if, depending on the view, you could be looking at what you thought was a hard edge. But if you tilt it a little, you see that really there's a circle on the side and there's four hard edges, okay? You want to pick that edge that's the highest in the tree. And it would be really nice if the CAD program would just list them that way, because it knows where it is in the tree. So if when you went to pick it and you do, what do you call that thing where you're right, quick pick. If quick pick automatically sequenced so that the element that's highest in the tree was at the top, it would work cool. So rename them. Rough groupings. These are functional. Then within the sequence, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this because every video you see here, you can watch as many times as you want at resilientmodeling.com. Okay, and lastly, the one rule. If you can see it, link to it, but pick the best parent, not the first. The first might be that circle on edge. Okay, Now, I'm going to show some examples. The first one will be that, remember the casting that we did that ECO thing? We'll step through that. And pay attention to this. This is a playback of a model. And I've spent a lot of time getting this so it's very easy to understand because it's critical, because my goal is to play back one feature every 2 seconds, which means a 60-feature model, I want to play back in 2 minutes and have the person that's watching it totally understand how that thing was made. So let me know if I came close.
In this video, we will use the same casting as before, but this time it will be created using the principles of resilient modeling strategy.
The resilient modeling tree is divided into 6 groups and always starts with the skeleton group. This sketch is the first feature in the model. It defines the interfaces between this part.
Notice and creating parts in the current model. Feature.
Rather than creating sketches using model faces, this feature provides reference surfaces. The second group contains the core features. The overall shape and size of the model is determined here.
Create the base feature by extruding 4 cylinders. Extrude the body to connect the cylinders. Create a cylinder at the body's center. Extrude a hex-shaped coaxial to the cylinder. Add a tombstone-shaped extrusion.
The detail group contains features that add functionality to the core model, such as slots, holes, and grooves. One of the most important rules in resilient modeling is detail features should never link to another detail feature.
Replace the tombstone face with a body face. Extrude an input fitting. Extrude a vent fitting. Extrude an 8mm rib. Create a boss by adding material to a cylinder. Add a hole to the boss.
The modified group is where we replicate features or tilt surfaces to create draft.
Replicate the boss and hole for a total of 4 instances.
Up to this point in the model, all features are prismatic. Every edge and every surface is fully defined and driven by either dimensions or constraints.
The 6th group is the quarantine group. This group is used to isolate problematic features, then remove or consume material, leaving derived edges. Rounds and chamfers are the most common features found here.
Add threads to the vent fitting. Add threads to the input fitting. Round both sides of the rib 3.99 millimeters. Round the base of all bosses. Round the top of all bosses. Quite easily done.
Okay, now, let's see, I think the next one. Who's the question? Yes. Well, I was thinking my first slide here was the first base feature. If you remember it, it was 4 cylinders. I mean, how many people would have thought to use that as your base feature? But if you go to the feature priority chart, you want to capture the features that define the interface and the structure of the model. The interface is the location of the holes. So those 4 cylinders already nailed down the hole, and it's not going to go anyplace. They also defined the height of the boss, and they defined the body. So that base feature just about guaranteed, just that one feature guaranteed you a robust model. Okay, now, here's a more complicated model. And after this, we'll show how to do this as an assembly, a multi-body part.
Skeleton group of a connecting rod. The wrist pin is an extruded surface body. The crank pin is a revolved surface body. The cap flange is an extruded surface body. The side view layout is created using the default side datum and is linked to the previous surface bodies. to subtract notches features a revolved surface body. Next, we will look at the core group. The crank pin hub is an extruded protrusion that is driven by skeleton group data. The next solid feature is the wrist pin hub. The two hubs are now connected by an extruded web. The core group is completed by adding flanges to the hub. The next group is the surface group. The first feature in the surface group is a planar curve that is created to serve as the trajectory for the group profile cross-section. The group cross-section is created next as a planar closed group. We will now look at the detail group. Cut a planar surface onto the flange. Cut a group using a swept cut. Create alignment notches in the hub by subtracting a surface body from the hub. The holes group is next. Place a countersunk hole. Place two counter bore holes. Next, we will look at the modified group. Mirror the groove feature. Cut the fillet relief using the crank pin surface body. The final group is the quarantine group. Chamfer the four edges of the flange. Fillet both sides of the small hub. Fillet both sides of the big hub. Round both sides of the big hub. Quite easily done. The resilient connecting rod is finished. This is the resilient connecting rod assembly.
Now, remember that page that said if you want to try this yourself? Well, if you send that email, what you're going to get is a PDF of that was played here so that you can step through it slide by slide. And I made sure that there are dimensions and everything so you can completely create that model as a resilient model just by going through that PDF. And the same thing applies here. So you get those two PDFs, and from that you can make the casting as well as the connecting rod. So if we take a look here, we started out, I got to take that out of there because it doesn't have a reference model. But it has, got to work on this. I'll go to the next one. That's the easy way. But the PDF is correct. I just didn't put it into that slide. Sorry about that. So the next thing we're going to do is to take this connecting rod and we're going to create a multi-body part. How many people here have made multi-body parts? Wow. Three? Four? I would expect you would. Four people. This is the future, believe me. And this is where you don't want to create a bunch of geometry in an assembly to make sure that these parts fit. A multi-body part is a much cleaner way to do it. And in this next video, you'll see how to do it.
In the part modeling phase of resilient modeling.
By the way, this is not complete.
Resilient models. Starting with this chapter, we will learn about resilient assemblies.
If the parts in your project have little interaction, Lego-type design project is recommended. The design process is simple.
Start the project by designing the critical parts. Then populate an assembly with the critical parts using traditional made-in-aligned techniques. Resolve all of the interference and fit problems at the part level. Finish the project by adding on critical parts and fasteners to the assembly.
This bottom-up design strategy works well on small design projects, but becomes problematic if the parts are interactive.
In real life, we visualize a product in its assembled state rather than as a collection of parts. As a result, we are more comfortable with a design approach where the other parts in the product are visible in the background. Since you can see a mating part in the background, it's natural to want to include the mating part's geometry in your design. Managing the resulting inter-part links is the major challenge for this top-down design strategy. Since the mating part is visible in the background, common geometry can be copied or linked. Common methods to manage part interfaces are: copy the geometry without links. The parts will be updated at the part level. Create links between parts. The parts will be automatically updated. Link to a skeleton body. Change the skeleton body to update the parts. Create a multi-body part. publish the parts to be used in the assembly.
For highly interactive parts, resilient modeling uses multi-body parts.
Converting RMS model to RMS multi-body model is easy. Place all groups except the skeleton in a folder. Create a folder for the next body. Start the new body with its core group. Link to the skeleton group, but don't link to other bodies. This is the resilient connecting rod assembly.
Told you it wasn't done. No. So, the idea is that the skeleton group is collecting product data, not part data. Okay? That's what the skeleton group is, where you take all of the calculations that you did before you even started the model, and you collect them there. So it's a natural place to start the model. And you do it with with layouts, and you also use things like surface models. If you think of the connecting rod, the first two features were surface models, okay? One of the wrist pin and the other of the crank pin, okay? And they were exactly what the size of the crank pin. Think about this. You're working on an engine with a team. After you complete those first two skeleton features, you can save your model and put it into an assembly, because we can assemble to those surface features. Now it can sit there in the assembly, the final assembly, and every time someone opens up the final assembly, they'll see how you're progressing on the connecting rod, okay? Or maybe you don't want to do anything till someone tells you how long the rod is going to be. But why wait? It's parametric. It's only one number, okay? So the whole idea is that what's new here is really the skeleton group, and that's where we're collecting our data. Now, you saw me make folders and put parts in. What if you've got a three-feature part? You're going to make three folders? That's kind of redundant. So here's what I do. Is I will, like, look at this one. I have a two-character code here, and this is the core feature, CR, detail feature 1, detail feature 2, modify feature 1 and 2. If this thing grows enough, I'll put a folder in there. But the folders aren't required to make resilient modeling work. But so after I finished body A, that's what you saw the playback of, then we start body B, another folder, and these are the features in that. Then body C, which is very simple, it's just this bearing. And then body D is the crank pin bearing, which is this one. What's a little tricky is that we have here some notches in the crank, connecting rod, and then we've got tabs here, and they're to keep that bearing from spinning when you put the crank, the connecting rod on. And they're done with a boolean subtract. Old school? Well, I'm older than dirt, so I love booleans. I think they're fun. Okay, now, give you a little preview here, and commercial alert. I'm doing another session right after this one in another room. And I should tell you the room. Thank you. In room 236. And there it's going to be totally examples, and it's going to be a model airplane engine. And I'm going to use that, and that model airplane engine is going to be the next example here, just the core group of it, because I'm going to illustrate a technique that I call inside-out design. If they can come up with words like top-down and bottom-up, this is mine, inside-out, and let me know what you think of it. Well, so far, not very interesting, is it? Okay, That's better.
In this example model, we will look at the core group of a model airplane engine crankcase. We will model a crankcase using the interior faces and then do a shell out operation. The crankcase is a part where the interior faces are critical, but the model is often created using the exterior faces because they are easier to measure and visualize. The core group contains 7 features. The first 6 features add material to define the interior of the crankcase. The last feature creates the exterior walls by shelling out the model.
The crankcase body is the base feature. It was created using a revolved protrusion. The crankcase cylinder was also created using a revolved protrusion. The Venturi used data from the side layout to create a revolved protrusion. The side transfer port is an extruded protrusion. The center transfer ports are an extruded protrusion terminated by a key point. The exhaust port was created by extruding a profile extracted from the port profile layout. The last feature in the core group is a shell feature. The new faces created by this feature are highlighted.
An additional benefit of the shell out operation is that the new faces are growing rather than shrinking. This makes a traditionally unstable feature very robust. Since the model is prismatic and robust, the unique thickness operation is now very useful. Inside out design gives precise control and visualization of interior faces. How many parts have you designed by creating the exterior faces and then used a traditional shell feature to create the important faces?
So one of the things that you've seen in a couple of the models is where I have just flat planar surfaces and I put them in the skeleton group and I call them sketching surfaces. And the reason they're in there is I want to eliminate parent-child links. Anytime you make a sketch on a face, you create a link to the feature that has the face, and then, unbeknownst to you, you also create a link to some straight edge on that face that is used solely to tell the CAD program how to orient the sketch. And that creates often a very surprising link that you don't even know is there until that face is modified and that link is there. And now you've got this feature that fails and you can't imagine how it has anything to do with another feature. So anytime I use a face to create a sketch, I'm creating 2 links, 2 parent-child features, and neither one of them contributes any design intent. So I put them in the skeleton. I do them all in one feature because all I'm doing is extruding off of, the side layout. And they can also furnish key points for the extent of another extrusion. Now, in this core, had what? Oh, I don't know, maybe 5 features. There isn't a single dimension in the core group and a single key point in the core group. Everything is linked back to the skeleton group. So you want to change that crankcase? You go to the skeleton group and you change it and it'll respond. Now, this thing is a multi-bodied part eventually, and it's got 6 pieces to it. It's got the piston, it's got the connecting rod, it's got a crankshaft, and it's got a cylinder head, and it's got a back plate. And they all feed off the skeleton group. And every one of their core groups has no dimensions in it. That's the goal. So, questions?
And I would argue that is the worst possible name for a 5mm round because, number one, it's self-evident because you just hover over and get it in the toolkit. Number two, it's not descriptive of the purpose of the feature or the lifespan of that feature in terms of the context of what you're doing. But the most important reason is that when it becomes a 4mm round, how many people are going to remember to rename it if they make the edit?
That's a good point. How would you do it? Clever answer, huh? How would you do it?
How would you explain it to somebody at the shop, I guess?
You could do round one, or you could do round with some type of description right after that's more relevant to...
Okay, let me ask you this. It's got a 4mm round.
Uh-huh.
Okay, how many 4mm rounds are there in the model?
Well, that's the thing.
And maybe you're going to put a lot of them in one group. Now, what you're going to see next time is that that cylinder, that crankcase, has about 10 different round features, okay? And it's called a round because that's what it is up in the ribbon. It's a round, and it's telling you what the feature is, okay? You'll also see there that I don't advocate putting all rounds in the same feature. Because believe it or not, you put 10 rounds in the same feature and they're interacting, the sequence that you pick the rounds will determine what their intersection looks like. And there's more than one way. What I recommend is take all the rounds in one direction. In the crankcase, they're the vertical ones, okay? The vertical edges, you round those. When you get done, then you put the next round, which is the same size, but it's a separate feature, and it goes there. The purpose of the names is to give you a clue of what it's used for. And a lot of times I'll put in a round feature, I'm still going to call it a round, because it is a round. And I'm going to put the size in there. Well, okay, I'm going to take a look at this. I'm going to find a way to get a recording that they're recording with this stupid little microphone that I've got here. I'm going to find a way, and this is what I do on every one of my presentations. I go back and go through it, okay, and look at the questions and stuff like that, and that's how this is evolving. I mean, 2 days before I left for Cincinnati, after I did this presentation, I did it at the Tucson SolidWorks user group, 50 people. And I got some very interesting questions and comments there. And I also found out that I was spending too much time in the boring minutia column. I'm not a speech major, and anyway, I was spending too much time there, so I totally rewrote it. I got up Friday morning at about 4 o'clock, and I worked through Saturday, so I completely rewrote it. In September, I've literally reorganized this thing 3 times, because every time I present it, I learn more. This is really, the things that are being presented here aren't new. This is not anything earth-shattering. Most power users have used some of these techniques, but the key is how to present it and to be able to play back a model, and you're able to comprehend it. Now, show of hands, these 2 models that I played back, were you able to figure out how that model was made from the playback?
Yeah,
that's not bad. It wouldn't be that hard for a CAD program when you hit that playback button to play it back in that mode. Particularly if you could assign a view to each feature. And only where the feature can't be seen by the previous view. And you could literally refine the playback feature so it could play back a model just like that. Then how easy would that be to figure out how someone made a part? Particularly if they did it this way. Any other questions? Yes. Wait a minute, on the multi-bodied crank, on the connecting rod. Ah, yes, why didn't I make it as one and split it? Yeah, that would be the traditional approach. We make the part with the cap on the bottom, and then we do this zero kerf cut that suddenly comes up with two bodies, okay? But it doesn't exactly work that way, first of all. You remember the little notches? They become problematic. And it is a separate part, and it's manufactured a separate part. Because in reality, you don't cast the whole thing and cut it with a saw. You could if you had a virtual saw that didn't have any kerf. Because those two caps have to mate, and they have to mate hard. Okay? There can't be a gap. So when we actually cast it, we cast it as two separate parts. And by the way, how does resilient modeling do a casting? Very simple. I've got an eighth group you didn't hear about, okay? In the eighth group, we add material to make it back to the casting. I mean, it's kind of backwards to design a casting and then machine the thing. It's kind of like taking a sheet metal part and designing it flat and then folding it to see what we got, okay? You design what you need, and then when you're done, you add material where you did your machining, and you use direct edit features or just protrusions. It works great. Other questions? No, there are no constraints in a multi-body model. You just start making it, okay? And when you're making it, you're looking at the skeleton. You've suppressed the rod, okay? Now you're making the cap, let's say. You've suppressed the rod, so you're just looking at the cap and the skeleton. And you build it like that was the first part, okay? Now, the coordinate system is always going to be each part is going to have the same origin. So if you assembled it, you could use assemble by coordinate systems and you'd get a perfect fit. But in reality, I'd use mates because if I do it that way, then I can get an exploded view. Okay? Did that answer your question or just make it more confusing? Well, if you're going to the next session, we'll attack that later. Because I'll stay as late as you want. I'm not sure I'm going to go to the ball game, or pseudo ball game. Other questions? Yeah.
If you have variables or formula rather than values, does that need to be defined in one of your groups? Or
no, you just use it like you normally would. You still get.
Can you not tie yourself in a knot with variable trees too? Or I guess it's not really a tree, right?
Generally, I keep variables simple. Yeah. And for instance, if I've got a part where I want the spacing between two lines, two edges, to be the same as a vertical edge, I'll create a separation dimension and then make them equal. Up, oh, we just went over. So, if you want to see the rest of the story, go to the other room, and I don't remember what it was, 236, and I'll be there shortly.